There are, I think, certain landmarks in a young person's life that need to be remembered and need to be celebrated. And there's also some that they may or may not share with other people, but are also still important. So of course, you know, when the young person finally gets their driver's license, that's a really big deal because of the sense of independence that you receive. That first time you head off to college, especially if you move away from home for college, is also just a huge milestone. And I think another one, when you get your very first fake ID. Now, going to school in Tallahassee, there were some places that you could go if you were 18, and some that you still had to be 21 in order to get into. So I, wanting to get into those places because I was curious, tried to find a way to look older. So a friend of mine introduced me to somebody who could create these type of identification cards. Now when I looked at it, there were two things that were wrong. And I pointed them out to the young man who had made them. He did not seem as anxious as I was. I said here, you have me listed as 37. He said, well, you'll grow into it. I said, that's the least of the problems, though. You've also made me Chinese. Sitting in prison, John the Baptist must have been pretty disappointed and pretty disheartened. He had proclaimed the coming of the Messiah. He had been that voice crying out in the wilderness. And now, he was not sure and was not confident if that prophecy had been fulfilled. He had been faithful to the Lord. And now, he wondered what was to come of it. So he sends word to Jesus. And he asks him, are you the one for whom we have been waiting? Or should we continue to wait? Now Jesus chooses his words very carefully. He could have said anything to reassure John the Baptist. He could have just said, I am he. Yes, I am the Messiah. But he doesn't do that. Instead, he tells those disciples, go back and tell John what you see and hear. The blind have their sight, the lame walk, the poor have the good news proclaimed to them, and even the dead are being raised. Now, he doesn't just say this because these are the things that he's doing. He says this in the message to John because it's the fulfillment of a prophecy from long ago. Throughout Jesus' birth, ministry, death, and resurrection, he will fulfill prophecy after prophecy after prophecy. And because he fulfills these prophecies, we know his identity. Because others have come before Jesus claiming to be the one. And others have come after Jesus claiming to be the one. But only he came and was the one. The prophecy, of course, that Jesus is referring to is the prophecy from Isaiah. And we remember from several weeks ago when Jesus is handed that scroll from the prophet Isaiah in the synagogue. He reads those exact same words, and then he stuns everyone when he says, today these words are fulfilled in your hearing. And remember, they didn't exactly have a great reaction about it. They wanted to throw him off a cliff. I think it's important when we think about identity, that we find a way to make sure that we know who we're talking about. That when we say that Jesus is Lord, that he is Messiah, that we're sure that we know who we're talking about. But just as it says in the letter to James today about being patient, we also have to be patient and study carefully who is this person named Jesus. Because there's a lot of opinions floating around the world and even within Christianity about who Jesus Christ really is. And frankly, I think that as we prepare for Christmas morning and we have this wonderful idea of Jesus coming on Christmas morning and we open up that wonderful gift, that many people in the world are going to be disappointed when they meet Jesus. It's kind of like some kids that I know who, I won't mention their names, but I know them very well. That when they were 5 and 3 years old, Santa Claus showed up and left a big bag of toys from their grandparents. And they began to go through them and they unwrapped these toys furiously. Kids can unwrap a toy in 2 seconds flat. And whenever they got a toy, they would raise it up and just be in awe of the toy. And then when they opened it up and it was a shirt and tie, the child just did this. And he just ate over the shirt. And that's what we have to be careful of, because the Jesus who comes may not be the Jesus who we're expecting. So who are the different types of Jesus that other people are proclaiming? Well, there's Jesus the teacher. This is the Jesus that we hear about who told many parables, he told wonderful stories, he gave moral guidance to people. But it stops there. I can learn a lot from this Jesus. I can learn about loving my neighbor. But this Jesus didn't come to die for my sins. This Jesus didn't perform miracles. That stuff is just fiction. Then there's the Jesus who I call the genie or Santa Claus Jesus. This is the Jesus who has all the immense power. He's the one who performs all of the miracles. He heals people because he's a great healer. But I don't believe that he came to die for my sins, because God wouldn't do something that crazy. Nobody rises from the dead. And then last but not least is the actual, real Jesus Christ. The one who fulfills all of the prophecies. The one who is a great teacher, who is a great healer, but who offers himself as a sacrifice for many, who willingly embraces the cross, not because it was his first choice, because he could have said no, but because it was his Father's will, because it was the only thing that would save humanity. But this isn't the popular Jesus. Look, for example, at churches where there's a crucifix, and even realize that in that terrible picture of suffering, how much we sanitize it. There's no blood. Jesus is fully clothed. It's a hard thing for us to imagine a person willingly suffering for another person, even people they didn't know. But that's the Jesus who we love and worship and who loves us. Lent, Advent, is about preparation. So what gift, what Jesus are we going to open on Christmas morning? Will it be the flashy Jesus that requires batteries? Or will it be the true Savior? Let's take the next 2 weeks and really ask ourselves which Jesus we're waiting for. Because Christmas is coming. There's still time to shed those old ideas of who our Savior is and embrace that child in the manger. A quick word about the baby blue. Yes, I am the prettiest priest ever. On the third Sunday, we light that candle for joy, and we think, I think, a lot about Mary. And so that's why we wear this color today, pink or blue. And I think Mary is probably one of the least understood or misunderstood characters in the Gospels. Because we were talking about this in our Bible study, that we either elevate Mary too much or we leave her completely behind. And so the one thought that I would leave all of us with as we think about Mary perhaps over the next 2 weeks in her role and bringing Christ into the world is this. Mary experienced a lot of pain in her life. And I think probably one of the scariest moments in Jesus' early life is when she takes Jesus to be presented into the temple and someone tells her that this child will be a sign to be contradicted and that a sword will pierce her own heart as well. Imagine hearing that as a parent about your child. How would we react to know that this child's destiny could be one of death? And I think that's why she pondered all those things in her heart. So in 2 weeks, we have Christmas. In 2 weeks, we will shed all the darkness and embrace the light. It'll all be joyful. We'll sing all the Christmas carols that we want. But we still are not there yet. So I leave you with that question that I will ask myself as well over the next 2 weeks. Which Jesus will we open on Christmas morning?